You know, I was a bachelor for 39 years. Actually, my brothers and I have two brothers. Before any of us got married, we had a combined 102 years of bachelorhood. And when we got married in reverse order. My youngest brother, Jed, got married first, and then my middle brother, John, got married, and then I got married. And the one who really surprised everybody the most was my brother, John. He's a real smart guy, valedictorian of his class, jack of all trades. He's got a sawmill, he runs heavy equipment, he's got track hoes and big diggers and dump trucks, and he's got a pilot's license, and he can make anything, and he's a crack shot. He's just one of those guys. But he speaks rather deliberately. And he's got a big old beard. And he lives in a tiny little log cabin out in the Jack Pines. And the deal with John is, this is frankly none of your business. But the deal with him is that he was 35 years old and he'd never been on a date. He lived in a tiny little log cabin in the middle of nowhere. His only vehicle is a dump truck. But anyway, he'd never been on a date. And then one day, my mom called. And she says, your brother has a girlfriend. And I said, well, how can this be? Because you gotta understand that for me, this is like waking up one morning and finding a fifth face on Mount Rushmore. And so, part of the problem, I think, is that he just, he lives in this tiny little log cabin, as I said. And when I say tiny log cabin, I'm not speaking euphemistically. The deal on the cabin is that my brothers, after I left home, they built a little log cabin out in the woods on my brother Jed's farm. And my brother Jed owns the farm adjacent to my father's farm where I grew up. They built this neat little cabin. I mean, they cut everything the same, themselves, stripped the logs, notched the logs, built it. It's a wonderful little cabin. And it went so well that what they decided to do after that one was done is they said, they're going to build a second one and sell it to a tourist. So they start building this thing next to my brother Jed's machine shop and on Sunday afternoons when they have some spare time. They get it almost finished, and my brother John gets a chance to buy 80 acres on the far side of the swamp. Now, it's only about 3 miles as crow flies, but it's about 4 miles by road. And the thing is, there's this big swamp between the two places, so you can't just go straight there. And he buys this 80 acres, and he decides he's going to live in the cabin now. So he's going to put the cabin on that 80 acres. Well, they got to figure out how to get the cabin over to that property. So what they did is they got a bunch of channel iron, and they welded up this great big hitch in such a fashion that they were able to hook two hay wagons together in parallel tandem. And then they took my brother John's big traco, and they chained up the cabin, and they lifted it up, and they took it, and they set it down on those two hay wagons. And then they hooked the Massey Ferguson to the front of this contraption. And the Massey had plenty of power to pull it, but the problem with Massey is the tractor brakes are no good. The brakes wouldn't hold it if they had to stop. And so they took my brother's old pickup truck around behind it, and they bolted they ran a chain from the they ran a chain from the front bumper of the pickup truck to the one hay wagon. And that was their brakes. The problem is that the guy on the tractor couldn't see the guy in the pickup, so they used their firefighter radios. And the guy on the tractor would say, hit the brakes! And the guy in the pickup would go, and that's how they would stop this whole thing. So comes time to move it, and of course this thing is just way too wide for the road, and they're just breaking every rule in the book. And my brothers, both of them have CDL license, commercial driver license, and they run log trucks. And I mean, if they get caught on the road with this thing, they're going to lose their licenses, and the DOT guy is going to use up every page in his little ticket book by the time it's over. So they wait until 3 a.m. And then, because they're safety-minded, they made a lap in the hayfield first just to test everything. And when it all checked out, they pull out to the end of the driveway and they look left and they look right, and then they just went for it. And it was touch and go, and they had a couple of close calls and some real problems, and they finally made it over to the property, and they got the thing off the road and onto my brother John's property. And then my brother Jed, who hardly ever says a word, but when he does, it's great. He's the master of wry observation. He just went, "Well, let's not ever do that again." So my brother John sets up shop, starts living in this little cabin. And when I say little, I'm not just speaking euphemistically. If you step through his front door, directly to your left is a homemade wooden table. And if you then proceed in a clockwise manner around the complex, it's a table, stove, sink, refrigerator, wood stove, hot water heater, washer, dryer, chest of drawers, bathtub. And there's a little rug in the middle of that room, and you can stand on that rug and pretty much run everything. And you'll notice from my description that he's got electricity and he's got running water, but he's got no indoor toilet. He's got a little building out in the brush with the classic crescent moon cut in the door, and that's his bathroom. And then also, as I mentioned, he's living in this tiny little cabin in the middle of nowhere, and his only vehicle is his dump truck. If you ask him to come in and put some gravel on your driveway, he'll show up in his dump truck. If you ask him over for cocktails, he'll show up in his dump truck. So he's living in this little cabin with no indoor toilet and a dump truck, and somehow he has failed to hook up on the local dating scene. So comes the day when my mom calls and she says, "Your brother has a girlfriend." And I say, "How can this be?" And my mother says, "Well, as it turns out, she owns her own dump truck." So sure enough, it turns out this woman, she's been, you know, my brother does a lot of these jobs where he does a little driveway for somebody or digs a basement or something. And for 5 years, she's been bringing loads of gravel to some of his job sites. And apparently for 5 years, there's been a whole lot of this going on. So finally, after 5 years of that, she quite rightly decides, "Look, if I don't make a move, nothing's ever going to happen." So one day, she brings a load of gravel to his job site. She dumps the gravel. She lowers the dump box. She gets the tarp all rolled and all ready to go and pointed out the driveway. And then she summons up all her courage, and she goes out to my brother. He's sitting in his skid steer, and he shuts it off, and he pops the earplugs out of his ears, and she says, "If I asked you to go on a date, would you do that?" And my brother, who hasn't been on a date for 35 years, says, maybe. And I told him later there are better answers. But anyway, sometime within the next couple of weeks, and boy would I have loved to have tapped that phone call, they come to some agreement and then they start seeing each other. Now, my brothers and I stay out of each other's business. We are stoic Scandinavians. I don't want to talk about my feelings, and you can't make me. I hear all the time, oh, you gotta let it out, you gotta let it out. You know, I know people who have been letting it out for 30 years and they never seem to improve. So my brothers and I, we stay out of each other's business unless there's trouble, and then we're there for each other. So in this case, I don't ask. I met the woman, seemed like a very nice lady. Beautiful dump truck. Big, shiny red Mac, finer than any piece of junk he's ever run. But anyway, I don't ask how it's going, but a few months in, I have to borrow a log chain. So I drive out to my brother's and I walk up the trail through the jack pines to his cabin, and I find him down on the ground pouring footings for a tiny little addition. And I said, what are you doing? Putting in a bathroom. And I thought, oh ho. But I didn't ask, none of my business. But sure enough, a couple of months later, they announced that they are engaged to be married. Not only has she agreed to marry my brother, she's agreed to move into this cabin with him, but she does insist that before she moves in, he must install an indoor toilet. Now, as the brother who had had many relationships, all of them failed to this point, I took him aside and I said, well, you see, this is how it starts. First, she wants an indoor toilet. Where does it end? So she basically tells him you have to have the toilet in before the wedding. They get married at 10 a.m. on Saturday morning. He finishes installing the toilet at 4 p.m. on Friday afternoon. He finishes tightening the last screw or whatever, and he picks up the phone, which is right next to the toilet, because everything is right next to the toilet, and he calls her to basically tell her, the toilet is in, the wedding is on. She's not home. So as only my brother can, he says, he gets her answering machine, and he says, yeah. I got a message for you. He left her the ceremonial first flush.